chorale and chamber singers, the raven steals the light. The music that opened our concert, Ecco, Mormorar, was composed by Claudio Monteverdi, appearing in his second book of madrigals from 1590. It exhibits the complex imitative style of late Renaissance madrigals, with each new line of text introduced and elaborated with its own melodic idea. The poem by 16th century Italian poet Trecato Tasso imagines a serene sunrise reflected in ocean waters and glistening over high mountains. It is beauty, it is a sound for the scorched heart. Indeed, Monteverdi saves his most sublime melody for the end of the piece to realize this very sentiment. This next set of music, performed by the chamber singers, further explores this idea in the song pair of Si Chio Vorrei Morire, also by Monteverdi, and All This Night Bright Angels Sing, set by Sir Arthur Sullivan. In this next Monteverdi madrigal, the heart is not burnt, but is burning, passionately. So enraptured is the poet of the mouth, the kisses, and the tongue of his obsession that he would happily die in their throes. Of course, in poetry like this, when lovers say they hope to die, they are really saying that they would like to live. In response, All This Night serves as a guide to show the lovers while their eyes and souls might turn should love burn out. In this context, it refashions the hymn text, Sun, to speak instead of its homonym, the sun. Its imagery becomes that of the light of the world, now joyfully overcoming the darkness.
Oh,
turn to our featured event of the evening, The Raven Steals the Light, a choral collage. Its inspiration is the work of Native American artist Bill Reid. After his first career working for the Canadian Broadcasting Company, Reid spent the second half of his life drawing, painting, and sculpting images from the mythology of the Haida Gwaii Native Americans of the Pacific Northwest. His style features ornate curves and bold ovoid shapes, particularly in the eyes of his subjects. His most striking work is the boxwood carving entitled The Raven and the First Men, on display at the University of British Columbia in Vancouver. The many images of the raven you will see on screen during the performance are his. The raven is the central character of the Haida stories. He is selfish, sly, and scheming, and to the Haida, consequently responsible for all they saw in nature and civilization. Reid helped to write the accessible versions of the myths. The narrative tonight is based on his book of texts and the drawings on the raven. This choral collage integrates music, word, and image into a complete illustration of the raven's plot to take the light of the universe. It appropriates music, sometimes in excerpt, sometimes transformed, sometimes in complete setting, to give musical life to the story. It draws from the works of many 20th and 21st century composers. We are grateful for the opportunity to include Richard Einhorn's Fire of the Dove from his film score, Voices of Light. But it especially highlights the stunning works of Eric Whitaker, whose music has overtaken the choral world, most recently through the global collaborative performances of virtual choirs. To allow the full story to take its shape, we greatly appreciate your withholding of applause until its end. This is The Raven Steals the Light, a choral collage.
Just make out the words, I have a box, and inside the box box is another box, and inside it are many boxes, and in the smallest box of all is all the light in the world, and it is all mine, and I'll never give it to anyone. It only took an instant for the raven to decide to steal the light for himself, but it took a lot longer for him to invent a way to do so. First, he had to find a door into the house. But no matter how many times he circled it, or how carefully he felt the planking, it remained a smooth, unbroken barrier. Sometimes he heard either the old man or his daughter leave the house to get water. Which the girl was dipping in the water. Even in his much diminished form, the raven was able to make a very small magic, enough to make the girl so thirsty she took a deep drink from the basket, and in doing so, swallowed the needle. The raven slithered down deep into her warm insides and found a soft, comfortable spot where he transformed himself once more, this time into a very small human being, and went to sleep for a long, long time.
A silver thread on darkness.
And as he slept, he grew. The young girl didn't have any idea what was happening to her. And of course, she didn't tell her father, who noticed nothing unusual because it was so dark. Until suddenly, he became aware of a new presence in the house, as the raven at last emerged triumphantly in the shape of a human boy child. He was, or he would have been, if anyone could have seen him, a strange-looking boy with a long, beak-like nose and a few feathers here and there. In addition, he had the shining eyes of the raven, which would have given his face a bright, inquisitive appearance if anyone could have seen his features then. And he was noisy. He had a cry that contained all the noises of a spoiled child and an angry raven.
Look, the light has a soul that he did not.
could see nothing, and all he could feel was another box. His grandfather, however, heard his precious treasure chest being disturbed, and he dealt very harshly with the would-be thief, threatening dire punishment if the raven child ever touched the box again. This triggered a tidal wave of noisy protests, followed by tender importuning, in which the raven never mentioned the light, but only pleaded for the largest box. That box, said the raven child, was the one thing he needed to make him completely happy. As most, if not all, grandfathers have done since the beginning of the time, the old man finally yielded and gave his grandchild the outermost box. This contented the boy for a short time, but as most, if not all, grandchildren have done since the beginning, the raven soon demanded the next box. It took many days and much cajoling, carefully balanced with well-planned tantrums, but one by one, the boxes were removed. When only a few were left, a strange reading, never before seen, began to infuse the darkness of the house, disclosing vague shapes and their shadows, still too dim to have definite form.
So
shot through the smoke hole of the house and into the huge darkness of the world.
I vow I will to what does a steeped and burning young I will take the souls in my soul and bring them to the sky where the light reveals us. To trash against the dark.
Mountains and valleys were starkly silhouetted, the river sparkled with broken reflections, and everywhere life began to stir. And from far away, another great winged shape launched itself into the air as light struck the eyes of the eagle for the first time and showed him his target. The raven flew on, rejoicing in his wonderful new possession, admiring the effects it had on the world below, reveling in the experience of being able to see where he was going instead of flying blind and hoping for the best. He was having such a good time that he never saw the eagle until the eagle was almost upon him.
All day, they are too slow, fully seen.
on the ground below, and they are shattered into pieces. Exhausted by the long chase, the raven finally let go of his last piece of light. Out beyond the rim of the world, it floated gently on the clouds and started up over the mountains, lying in the east. Its first rays caught the smoke hole of the house by the river, where the old man sat weeping bitterly over the loss of his precious light and the treachery of his grandchild. Sadness disappeared like tears in rain.